Hello, you lovely people. From last episode, we were in a galaxy far, far away. Now we are firmly on terra firma, with a little bit of folk horror for you, aimed primarily at the time for the children. Yes, dear viewer, we go back to the halcyon days of kidult television, as we get all Neolithic and squat on the nearest ley line. Can you feel those vibrations? Good. Let's look and look again at HTV's Children of the Stones. Children of the Stones has gained something of a cult following, and it's now heralded as one of the definitive examples of true cult television, petrifying children and adults alike when first broadcast in 1977. The layered, labyrinthine plot echoes and combines elements of movies and TV programmes that came before it, such as Nigel Neal's Quatermass and The Pit, 1957's Epiphany, I do apologise, Epiphany, to the occult Night of the Demon.
It's in the trees. It's coming.
1960s Kiddie Creeper, Village of the Damned. 69's Enchanting the Owl Service. '72's Hypnagogic Escape into Night.
We're coming.
Goodness sake, go and turn it off! It's them!
And of course, Nigel Neal's last word on phantom phenomenon, the Stone Tape, from 1972. And not forgetting, of course, 73's last word on bucolic belligerence, the Wicker Man. On its original broadcast, critics firmly believe that such a programme overstepped the mark for a children's TV slot, despite the horror being implicit rather than explicit in the show. What we have here, dear viewer, is a truly formidable weave of science fiction and horror, producing some first-class blood curdles, where a father and son are catapulted into a maelstrom of ancient forces trying to be unleashed in a pastoral chocolate box village setting. The programme was conceived by actor-screenwriters Jeremy Burnham and Trevor Ray, who met and became good friends whilst working on the BBC TV show Paul Temple in 1969. Both had a passion for writing a television script and developing a series of their own, and took inspiration from Alfred Watkins' book The Old Straight Track, which homes in on ley lines and debated whether they are prehistoric scientific legacy lost in time, and as to whether these are indeed science fiction or science fact. Ley lines, in case you were unaware, are straight lines connecting one antediluvian structure or monument with another. The lines are not visible, but are psychic streams that can usually be sensed by those with the gift of a second sight, or those brave enough to tap into it. The structures themselves are totemic intersections where the lines cross, and act as a kind of receptacle where the energy is pocketed at its most powerful, and where, possibly, such an energy source can be harnessed. Anyway, Burnham and Ray expanded on their concept, and when satisfied, approached HTV, which catered for the West Country region of England, and we had our own geographical, televisual identity at the time. And what they did is they pitched their idea to executive producer Patrick Drom-Gool, who had already achieved success with 1973's Arthur of the Britons, the Georgian House, and the kidult drama Sky. Drumgool and HTV were impressed with their pitch and commissioned the series. Location-wise, Burnham and Ray stuck with the West Country, already featured in Sky, except here the Glastonbury locale was transposed to Avebury and Wiltshire. Avebury was totally on point, as Avebury contains the largest megalithic stone circle in Europe. The Henge Monument and stone circles are notably unique. As well as its size, it is exclusively a henge with a village constructed partly within it. Henge, of course, is a name for an oblique Neolithic fortification consisting of a ledge with a trench on the inside. Avebury is about 3/4 of a mile in circumference and in times past was up to 29 foot deep. The biggest outer circle has two smallest inner circles within it. The stones are sarsen, silicified sandstone blocks, which are found in southern England on the Marlborough Downs and Salisbury Plains in the county of Wiltshire. That would have, in ancient times, taken plenty of manpower and skillful manoeuvring to get them here, and no doubt resulted in a few fatalities along the way. The jury's out on what the stone circle may have been used for, however. Archaeologists believe that it may have been an ancient place of worship and ceremony, or a pagan moot for communal celebration, and possibly sacrifice. An excavation of the stones in 1937 by archaeologist Alexander Keeler unearthed the skeletal remains of a medieval barber surgeon who was crushed to death beneath the stone when it was probably being interred by those who wanted to discard the pagan stones from public view, and of course, what they represented. Now, viewer, that's what you get for interfering in things that should be left well alone, and a complete ignorant disregard of past times, ignoring the deserved respect we owe to our ancestors and pagan heritage. This crushing tragedy was in fact sneaked into the programme itself.
Yes, 40 tons. Wouldn't like to get caught under that.
Someone was caught centuries ago. The barber surgeon. He was helping to bury one of the stones when it crushed him to death.
And he was found?
Earlier this century. When they re-erected the sarsen, his skeleton was found underneath.
Why were they burying the stone?
Local superstition. The villagers believed that if they buried one of the stones each year, it would bring them luck.
Burnham and Ray were no strangers to the area and frequented Avebury before they wrote the series. Burnham recalled that when they visited there, they witnessed
a large crow alighting on the back of a ram, after which both of them remained motionless. We knew then that this was the sort of place where strange things happen.
Director Peter Graham Scott was asked to direct Children of the Stones after he met Patrick Trumgall whilst in Cannes, looking for other projects after he became dissatisfied with what the BBC had to offer him. Graham Scott recalled,
Patrick had this script in his hotel room. He said, I'll let you read the first episode, and if you want to read any more, come and see me. I said, stop mucking about, give me the other 6 parts, but he said, I'll give you the other 5 parts and hold out on the last one. It really was a cliffhanger. Once I read it, I said, look, Patrick, I've got to know.
Graham Scott further added,
it was an interesting script, I liked everything about it. It may have been a children's story, but it was about something beyond our conception, an idea in a way we are ruled not only by the stars but by these stones erected by people in Neolithic times. There was some reason behind it, like the reason behind the pyramids. These stone circles have something to do with the stars and with some part of our brains that has atrophied. Although they didn't understand electricity, we don't understand what strange forces they were attracting with these stones. This is what really fascinated me, a way of interesting viewers in more things in heaven and earth.
Graham Scott adored the location, but to ensure the stone circle looked even more dramatic, jabalite stones were constructed featuring prehistoric patterns integral to the enigmatic ambience. Whilst on location in Avebury, Graham Scott recalled that
a Dutch lady tourist, who did not speak any English, was asked by an assistant director to move please as she was in shot. She didn't understand. He waved her away. She bounced up against one of the stones and it fell over. She nearly had a heart attack.
He was then asked to select the cast, and he chose actor Gareth Thomas to take the lead of the father, Adam Brake. Character actress Veronica Strong took the part of red-headed MILF Margaret. Ian Cuthbertson took the role of a villainous interpretation of Hendrik, and veteran actor Freddie Jones as derelict Di. The child actors were Peter Demon playing Matthew, Adam's son, and 16-year-old Catherine Levy playing Sandra. Graham Scott said of Levy,
"They were very good, particularly the girl Catherine Levy. When she was supposed to be possessed, she managed to get her eyes somehow defocused so that she literally looked remote and odd."
The production began shooting at breakneck speed in the hot summer of 1976, which, due to the exceptionally clement weather, resulted in sustained sunshine. And there the crew managed to perfect shafts of bright sunlight beaming onto the stones. These sequences are flawless, harnessing an energy from Mother Nature herself without the need of crude special effects. Another unsettling element, of course, was the music. Another stroke of genius by Graham Scott, who remembered,
"That came about because I was listening to the car radio, and some music came on by the Polish composer Penderecki, a theme for voices without words. I argued that we didn't know what Neolithic language was, but they must have somehow communicated, or else how could they have put up the stones? I wanted to create a sound almost like a work song, where they're heaving away." Sidney Saiga, the composer, listened to Penderecki and heard exactly what I wanted. "We booked the Ambrosian singers who really went into the spirit of it. The notes that echoed really sounded quite chilling."
The cappella vocalizations by the Ambrosian singers, chanting seemingly an Icelandic word, hadave, combined with a discordant, lamented counterpoint, was surely exceptional to children's programming of the time. With the series in the can, Children of the Stones was unleashed on an unsuspecting child audience on Monday afternoons and produced many a sleepless night. The plot of Children of the Stone sees astrophysicist Adam Brake and his son Matthew arrive at the reticent village of Milbury. Adam wants to research the megaliths and, due to the death of his wife, wants to start a new life with his son, leaving the past behind them. Adam befriends the local museum curator Margaret, who, along with her daughter Sandra, also new to the village, just seemed that little bit ordinary compared to the other locals. However, both begin to feel a sense of unease. Milbury, despite its charms, also has a distinct eerie quality, which Adam attributes to the presence of the stones. Matthew attends the village school and notices a distinct wedge between some of the children in the class who display genius qualities and the others who do not. The ones that don't have a lesser IQ, and they are all the newest arrivals. As Adam and Matthew make contact with the stones, they begin to experience a form of unexplained psychic disorientation. Most individuals in the village seem odd in their behaviour, charming enough, but rather submissive, as though they are being controlled by someone or something. Eventually, Adam and Matthew meet Hendrik, a Lord of the Manor type figure. However, his behaviour is as equally charming as it is unctuous. It is later revealed that Hendrik has a very special connection to the stones. One evening, Matthew finds himself woken by chanting and sees the villagers in a circle performing some kind of ritualistic incantation. As once ordinary acquaintances begin to change in demeanour and intellect, Matthew and his father realise that an ancient power is to be resurrected with the force from a black hole, and Milbury may be a time trap where you enter but can never leave. What are Hendrik's plans in summoning an archaic force? What is the connection between these chilling events and an old picture Matthew picked up in a junk shop? And can the father and son escape the grip of Milbury and hold onto their individuality? As well as the TV programme Sky, Patrick Drumgold cites this as one of his favourite accomplishments as executive producer for HTV, and acknowledged it as
a very complicated story at that. A story about time and the repeating of time. Very difficult to follow.
When Drumgold was challenged about the story being unsuitable for children, he responded to the provincial stance by saying,
"Everything you do on television is compromise. You've got hundreds of rules to bear in mind. Children adore to be scared and it does them good to be scared. You've got to be desperately careful not to damage them."
For me, Children of the Stones mixes elements of one of my all-time favourite films, The Wicker Man, where a secluded rural community, all but disappeared, now are in the servitude of bygone rites. Also, it nods to another plot, that of Invasion of the Body Snatchers, where a demographic appears formidably placid and abnormally complacent, and via the skill of director, producer and actors involved, manages to produce a great series, equally creepy and ethereal, as though both its adult stablemates, without ever being vividly gruesome in honour of the fact that it's made for a child audience. At first, Children of the Stones appears it's going to be a light-hearted hokum of esoteric fare with the odd spell, wizardry, and varied mystic trappings, but it slowly morphs into an ingenious fusion of the primal with a delightful, hard-edged science fiction idea right at its core. The skill in plot and the way the whole mise-en-scene unfolds is that of surprising maturity and tenacity the majority of contemporary grown-up British series can only dream of. This gem never insults or patronises the audience it aims for. It's not just the well-articulated hard sci-fi angle, but themes such as xenophobia, the sacrifice of individualism, and the determination to create an insipid, faceless totalitarianism, where everyone behaves in exactly the same manner, which is truly unnerving. And in 2022 is far closer to home than probably in 1976. And sadly, in these times as ours, is too close for comfort. Gareth Thomas, a year before he became the iconic Blake, swaggers through his part as a mildly imperious, omnipotent, but highly charismatic Adam, and the wonderful Ian Cuthbertson being pleasantly creepy as the duplicitous, almost diabolical Hendrick, are standout characters. Even the children cast here refrain from the annoyingly cringe fresh out of stage school qualities, and again are likeable, identifiable. The real grand slam of the piece are those amazing megaliths encompassing the village and dominate the immediate area, standing there as muted, clandestine sentries. Yes, the show is a slow burner, but like most of TV from this era, evolves and flows out into a gripping ocean which make up its seven parts, spinning an ingenious web of baroque, alternate realities and time trap narrative in amongst what at first glance appears to be a load of old hippie shit. The ending, without giving anything away, is also unsettling, and it's that final frisson that for me seals the deal. This is classic television at its absolute best, and a crucial purchase for any retro fan or lover of what constitutes the pinnacle of what we fondly remember as the golden age of television. Until next time on Look, Look and Look Again, happy day and cheerio.
Can you talk a little bit about the location filming at Avebury and what that was like, and whether, you know, whether the atmosphere of Avebury kind of rubbed off on you or the cast?
We were based in Bristol as the sort of the studios, and 90% of the filming was done out at Avebury, and a lot of it inside the Stone Circle. I think I'm right in saying that the village of Avebury was actually built inside the Stone Circle, but the church is built outside it. When we filmed there, it was a long hot summer, And various things happened, not to me, but various things happened. One, I remember, three or four of the crew, their watches went completely haywire inside the circle. No apparent reason, just went haywire. There was a shot where Freddie Jones, as Di, the sort of tramp or whatever, snared a rabbit, and the young lad let it free. I think, if I remember right, it became very funny. Oh, cut! Let's have another rabbit! I mean, we went to about seven or eight rabbits on that one, because they just did run, and of course we just left in the pond. You couldn't catch them again. But I think the one...
How successful was the series?
I gather it was very successful at the time. One thing that has surprised me, and always does surprise me, is that it's never been shown again. I did a series after that called Blake 7, which was also very popular. It was pure science fiction. I wouldn't say that Children of the Stones are science fiction, but somebody who's interested in science fiction may well have watched Children of the Stones. And I've been amazed by the number of people who are fans of Blake 7 who keep on coming back to Children of the Stones and saying, oh, you remember when you did Children of the Stones? Because they've all seen it. And that puts the figure at somewhere, I don't know, sort of 8 or 9 million. And so I'm very surprised it's never been reshown. Because I remember at the time people saying, that's a cracking good series, and, oh, isn't it a good story? And I seem to remember some people saying the acting's not bad either. but it was very successful at the time. But as I say, it's never been repeated. And I would have thought that it's a perfect one to repeat. Because having watched it recently, which incidentally is the only thing that I've ever watched that I've done on television, and been suitably embarrassed by it. But apart from my bouffant hairstyle and being a lot slimmer and all of us looking an awful lot younger, and some very strange clothes I was wearing, strange colours I wouldn't dare wear now. But apart from that, it actually still holds up very, very well. I mean, both the story and even, I mean, Avery hasn't changed. I was down there about 6 months ago, and it's still exactly the same as it was then. A few more tourists. But, I mean, I'm very surprised. It was very popular.
Anger of fire. Fire of speech. Breath of knowledge. Render us free from harm. Return to us the innocence that once we knew. Complete the circle. Make us at one with nature and the elements.
It is time.
Changing.